the darkness today. Let Yahweh praise the darkness. Let Yahweh praise the darkness. Let Yahweh pierce the darkness. He is Yahweh. He is Jehovah. He is El Elyon. He is Elohim. He is great and mighty. He is God alone, and there is no other beside him. He is the King, the Messiah, the one who sits on the throne. He is the sovereign Lord. Hallelujah! For Yahweh. Merabah.
You are not a God. mention of your name. You're the only God who's worthy
of
all the praise he can give.
You are Lord. Issue of love. Some of you gotta press through the crowd today. Some of you gotta press through your financial difficulties. Press through the challenges at the office. Press through the sickness. Press through the loss of the job. Press through troubles in your marriage. Press through problems with your children. Press through because He is God alone. In the good times and the bad, we gotta press through. So press. Press through the crowd today. Press and give God the praise. Press. Press. Whatever your issue is, press into God. Press today. Hallelujah. Whatever your issue is, press and touch the hem of God's garment so that power can flow, so that grace can flow, so that strength can flow, so that anointing can flow. Oh, press. Press through your crowd today. For He is God alone. Press. Some of you need to press. Some of you need to press. Come on. Some of you need to press. Some of you got some stuff you need to press. Hallelujah. For in the good times and the bad, He's unchangeable. He's immovable. He is unshakable. Nobody can stop Yahweh. Nobody can stop Yahweh. So press. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Press. That's the word for some of you today. Press through the crowd. Press. And give God praise. In the good times and the bad, God is sovereign. Yes. Yeah, Rabbi Sunday. say. Come on, you are the worship leaders this morning. You sing. Come on and worship. You sound great, Sovereign Lord. Lord is holy. The Lord is righteous. The Lord is majestic. The Lord is wonderful. The Lord is beautiful. The Lord is gracious. The Lord is mighty. The Lord is in control of your life. The Lord is in control of your circumstance. The Lord is in control of your situation. The Lord is in control of your marriage. The Lord is in control of your job. The Lord is in control of your body. The Lord is in control. The sovereign Lord who sits on the circle of the earth, who has his enemies as his footstool. The Lord who created the worlds, who said, let there be, and there was. The miracle working God, the sovereign Lord is in control. The Lord is in control. The majestic one, he reigns supreme. The eternal God is on the throne. The Lamb is on the throne. And nobody has nothing with our God. Nobody has nothing with our God. No devil has nothing with our God. No principality has nothing with our God. Satan has nothing with our God. Because he's still got to seek God for permission to touch you. That is who God is. God is mighty. God is powerful. God is the righteous judge. He is the everlasting, eternal God. He is the King of the kingdom. The Lord God omnipotent reigns forever and ever. And that is why we worship the Lord. Our God is bigger than any other God. Our God is bigger than any other God. He's bigger than the heavens. He's bigger than your stuff. He's bigger than your circumstance. He's bigger than your sickness. He's bigger, he's bigger, he's bigger. Encourage yourself in the Lord today. Encourage yourself in the Lord today. Whatever it is you're facing, encourage yourself. For God is in control. God is in control. God is in control. Your God is in control. Don't be discouraged today. Don't be discouraged today. Don't be discouraged today. Your God has got you covered. So give him all the praise. Just give him all the praise. Just give him all the praise. Just give God all the praise. Come on and bow in his presence today. Come on and bow in his presence today. And give God all the praise.
Change, you are in control of my life today. And
You before, know that God doesn't change, and He'll do it again. He restored your joy before. Know that God, He will do it again. He's touched your family before, He saved them. Know that your God, He'll do it again. Whatever difficulty, whatever accusation, whatever sickness, whatever problem. Father, we thank you that you are in control. And we thank you by faith, God, knowing that you will come through for us. Knowing, God, that you've done it before and you will do it again because you do not change. You are the same God today, yesterday, and forever. You do not change, God. So, Father, we lift our hands today. And we say thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. The situation hasn't changed today, but God, we are thanking you that it will change. It will change. It will change. Because you are God. Because you love us. Because you want to bless us. It will change. So God, we thank you. We don't have a job, but we thank you for providing the job.
Yeah.
Lord this morning is, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. Not me. In my Father's house there are many mansions. Many mansions don't mean you will have a little house with a top, but there's room in that mansion for everybody. Let not your heart be troubled. There's room for all of us. We don't have to hit one another to get there. The room is prepared already. Let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God. Believe in me. For in my Father's house, there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. For I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again, receive you unto my Father. Glory to God. Receive the word of God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for encouraging the hearts of your people today. Thank you, Lord.
Jesus. What an honor it is, God, to worship you. What a privilege it is to be in the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for being in our midst. Thank you, Lord, for dwelling amongst us, God. Father, this morning we just say, God, we honor you. We worship you. We thank you, God, for who you are. We bless your holy name, God. We join with angels around your throne and we say, holy is our God. Holy is our God. Father, we honor you today. We honor you today, God. We honor you. We honor you, God. Above all else, God, we give you the reverence, God. Above every situation and circumstance, we say, God, that you are exalted. You are lifted high. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. You are the Almighty One. You are the Sovereign God. You are the Great God, and we worship you this morning. Just because of who you are, just because of who you are, we honor you. And we are grateful this morning. We are grateful this morning for who you are. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Father. God will speak to us, to our hearts individually, as we incline our ear to hear him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. I'm going to ask Minister Sonia to come for a moment, and we want to lift up Sister Beverly Reese. She's in the hospital. We just want to, in this atmosphere, believe that the presence of the Lord is right where she's at right now. And he will minister healing to her in Jesus' name. And if you are in here and you have not just yet felt God has touched your situation, you raise your hand and receive the prayer right where you are.
Hallelujah. God has given us a covenant. He's a covenant-keeping God, and in his covenant, he has given us not an insurance policy, but an assurance policy. And in this policy, he said that healing is the children's bread. In the policy, he said, whatever we ask, it shall be given to us. And one of the things that anyone that creates anything, he always have spare parts. The one who created a car, he will have spare parts. And the greatest of them all, who is our Jehovah God, he is the creator and he has spare parts. If you want a heart this morning, we are going to put through a claim this morning on the assurance policy. And he said that if you want a kidney, whatever you want, he has spare parts. And you're the one that is going to make that claim this morning. All I'm going to do is state that claim and carry it up to the Father. So as we begin to pray for Beverly, we want you this morning to make the claim for yourself. Whatever you are in search of, whatever you need, because of the covenant, because of the policy, you're going to make that claim. He does not give us a percentage of that claim. In the Word of God says, whatever you ask, he will give you 100% of the claim. So this morning, we are going to get the new parts that we require. Whatever, God. Father, because you're sovereign, because you're a covenant-keeping God, Father, because you're a God that cannot lie, we approach your holy throne. And Father, first of all, if there's anything in us that will hinder the policy, God, we ask in Jesus' name that you will fix us up and make us clean. That as we approach you with our claims this morning, Father, we declare that just as your word says, it is written that healing belongs to us. Father, we put you a claim for healing this morning. Father, whatever is the situation with Beverly Reese this day, Father, we take the claim up to you on her behalf this morning, God. And we ask you, God, that you will allow your son, Father, the blood that he shed would pass over Beverly today. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Ghost, Father, whatever is her troubles today, Father God, because you are a creator with spare parts, we are not asking just for a fixing this morning, but we are asking for a newness, Father, give us a new body, Father, we are praying for those who are even in the congregation this morning, those who are listening, oh Father, Father, as we put through our claims this day, Father, for those who need a new kidney, those who need a new heart, Father, those who need a new mind, Father, those whose eyesights are bothering, those who need new ears, God, who need, oh Father, a new spleen, those who need a new liver, those who need a new back, God, those who need some new knees, Father, because you're the creator, God, we ask you, oh Jesus, you cannot reject our claim this morning, for God, you are God that cannot lie, you have made a covenant, you cannot break the covenant with your people, and therefore, God, we come boldly before your throne, and we claim unto you, God, that all that we ask shall be done, all that we ask shall be given. So, Father, because of Jesus Christ, because of his blood, because of his love, because of his mercy, Father, begin, oh Father, to do the surgery right now on Beverly Reese. Begin to do the surgery on each one of us. Father God, some of us need our blood transfusion. For God, the diabetes, oh God. Father, in the name of Jesus, those who have liver problems, those who have the skin problems, those whose blood need a cleansing, Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we ask, God, as you honor this claim, that we will be grateful. So in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, we say thank you. We say thank you. Thank you for healing. Thank you for deliverance. Thank you for restoration. For in the presence of the Lord, there's a fullness of joy. And at your right hand,
there are blessings, there are pleasures forevermore. So we thank you for this fullness. We thank you for this pleasure. We thank you for this blessing. In Jesus' name, amen.
Over us. He says, I am the Lord that healeth you. He says, I am the Lord your healer. He said he sent his word, Christ Jesus, and he healed every disease this morning, whatever is your disease this morning. God says, I am the Lord that healeth thee. Amen. Let's bless his name. Hallelujah. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Like the children to come. Someone wants to share a testimony. Just speak with Prophet Dwayne for a minute. Just share with Prophet Dwayne. And I'd really like the children to come at this time. You may be seated. Amen. Hallelujah. Children, come as you prepare to go to Children's Church. We really declare that God has truly ministered to you in your own way, even in this time of worship. For he does not forget the little children. He does not forget the little children. He said, suffer them to come unto me and not to forbid them. So even in the midst of the adult worship, God was with you and is with you. And so, Father, we just thank you for all of these little ones who are in the house of God today. We thank you for these little arrows, God. And Father, as they will go to Children's Church, we declare the blessings of God upon them. We declare that every spirit of restlessness will be gone from them, God, and that they will be attentive, even as their teachers would minister your love and your grace to them. Father, we declare that these little arrows shall be aimed in this nation, Barbados, God, and they shall come forth as lights in this dark nation, in the mighty name of Jesus. So, Father, bless them as they go to Children's Church, in Jesus' name, amen. The Lord bless you, children. The Lord bless you, teachers, as you go and minister to them, amen. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We're just going to hear a testimony, and then we are going to go into the Word of God. We thank all of you for being here this morning. We will have our official welcome at the end. We welcome all of those who are worshiping with us via live stream.
We want to bless you all. We welcome Apostle and Pastor Sandra. We're sure that they're joining us for service this morning. So good morning to all of you who are with us in the service from all over the world. May the Lord bless you in this time of worship.
Good morning, church. Just want to share a short testimony. 2 years ago, I was diagnosed with rheumatoid arthritis, which is an autoimmune disease. Friday gone was 9 weeks that I haven't taken any medication. Amen. On mornings when I get up, I couldn't even brush my teeth, bathe my skin. My husband had to do it for me. It take me till 10, 12 to thaw out like a piece of meat. But my God is good, and he has healed me. Amen.
Amen, amen, amen. I am the Lord, your healer. That is his word to us today. He is our healer. He sent his son to heal all of our diseases. And we're going to go into the word of the Lord right now. Elder Clifford is going to come and minister the word of the Lord. And then we will come back afterwards and share all the announcements and welcome you officially. But we are so happy that you're here with us this morning as we worship God. Elder Clifford.
Good morning. Good morning. We rejoice with those that have those great testimonies to share of God's healing. And that is an encouragement to all of you who are still looking for healing, who are still seeking a healing. God is not a God of favorites. If he does it for one, he can do it for you as well. So don't let your faith waver. Keep your faith strong in God, and know that he is your God as well. Amen? Praise God. God bless you. Hallelujah. This morning, I want to share. We are doing the series, A Power of a Transformed Life. A Power of a Transformed Life. And I want us to look at that from its foundational text this morning, which is really Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Father, we thank you for your word. Your word is truth. Your word is life. Your word is light. We ask God, as we should look into your word, as we should meditate upon your word this morning, that indeed it would bring us change. We want to look more like Christ. We want to talk more like Christ. We want to think more like Christ. And so, God, it's our desire that your word would penetrate our hearts and our minds and sow the seed within us, God, that will bear much fruit towards your glory. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. The power of a transformed life. That's the series that we were looking at. We've been looking at for the last couple of weeks, I think, going into months. And Apostle would have chosen Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. For our foundational text. This morning I want to have a subtitle, if you would, and call it A New Creation. You see, the power of a transformed life speaks of a new creation. A new creation. A new creation. And I'll be reading, you will see my text is taken from the ESV, that's the English Standard Version, and I'm just reading from that version this morning. You can follow with me on the screens. It says, I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Spiritual worship. Verse 2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that you may test, discern what is the will of God. I believe that is our goal this morning, to know the will of God. To know the will of God. The will of God for our lives individually, the will of God for our church, the will of God for our family, the will of God for our nation. The will of God is important. Amen? And so we will look at these two verses. As a matter of fact, what I want to do is kind of link it to another scripture. And this scripture is taken from 2 Corinthians 5:17. 2 Corinthians 5:17. It says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. And you will see some underlinings there. That is my own emphasis. But you'll see some underlinings there. And I want us to focus on that scripture for a second. Because the tense of that scripture is very important for us understanding how we are going to apply Romans 1 and 2 to our lives. It says, if anyone is in Christ, is in Christ. Let me see the hands of those that are in Christ this morning. You're in Christ. So we're speaking what? Present tense. And this goes present continuous, actually. If anyone is in Christ, he is, he is, he is, he is, he is, or she is a new creation. It's what the Word of God says. So let me see those that are new creations this morning. If you are in Christ, you are a new creation. The old has passed. The old what? The old has passed. It doesn't mean those that are over 50 like me. Thank God we ain't passed. And we ain't passing nowhere but to heaven, to God, which is a good pass. Behold, the new has come. You see how that verse is written? It brings us to the reality of the now. You are a new creation. Your old has passed. Your new has come. And so oftentimes in our minds, we like to think that we are going to try to become this new creation. And in the back of our minds, we start to wonder, how am I going to become this new creation? When in fact, God is saying, you are the new creation. You already has become a new creation. Now I want to explain or bring to bear two words as relates to our salvation. The first one is justification. And I think these two are very essential in our Christian or in God's salvation plan to us. Justification and sanctification. Justification can be defined as God's immediate embracing of the sinner at his or her genuine confession and repentance. This is when the new birth takes place. And a lot of times we use the word born again. Born again speaks of that new birth. So justification is an immediate effect.
It takes place immediately. Justification. Sanctification now is God's working by the Spirit, by His Holy Spirit, to bring us to the Christ-like life we are now to exhibit. This is a life process. And I have there, that continues as long as we are living on earth. And maybe, who knows, maybe after that. I can't speak for what happens after that yet. I'm not sure, but I know for sure it continues as long as we are on planet earth. Yeah? So we have sanctification and we have justification. Or let me switch it around. Justification and sanctification. And because of that, you are a new creation. You know, you and I now have the Holy Spirit to enable you and I to resist conforming to the world. So we can connect now to Romans chapter 12, verse 2. And we're going to focus on verse 2 primarily. Huh? You see, it is important that we understand our position in Christ. I remember that verse says, in Christ. It starts by saying, therefore, if anyone is in Christ. Your position in Christ makes all the difference. I want you to understand that. Your position in Christ is what gives you the victory. Is what enables you to say all these things, that you are a new creation. It is your position and my position in Christ. And so, as we bring it to Romans 12, 2, we can see now it is the Holy Spirit, and it's because we are in Christ that we are enabled, we are able to resist the conforming to the world. And that is important. That is what we are required to do. It says, do not conform. It speaks to us as how we relate to the world while we are in the world. And just as importantly, it continues, we need to remember that the Holy Spirit is also there to enable us to do something else. And that now is to go through the process of transformation. Because again, just like we need the Holy Spirit to resist the conforming to the world, we also need the Holy Spirit to enable us to be transformed. So the Holy Spirit plays a vital and a premium role in your life from beginning to end. Always remember that. And so it is justification, enabling sanctification. You can say it like that. Now there's a question that I grew up hearing, and I'm sure most of you heard, and it's somewhat like one of these little puzzle things. It says, which comes first, the chicken or the egg? How many have heard that question? How many know the answer? Only a few of you know the answer. Which comes first, the chicken or the egg? Shout it. Some saying egg and some saying chicken. What's that? Before? Oh, praise God. Well, let me just say this. I believe, this is just my belief, that as Christians who are reading the scriptures, that should be a pretty simple answer. Yeah? Because if we look at, I think, Genesis chapter 1, somewhere around verse 24, we see the answer. Did God create any eggs? No. God created chicken, or the fowl, you won't call it that. And that chicken or fowl laid the egg. So anytime anyone answers that question again, you know the answer. The chicken came first. God created chickens or fowls. It says in 24, your livestock. But that, I just use that to help us understand where we fall as it relates to salvation in terms of justification and sanctification. Always remember, justification came first. You were justified first. So unless you are saved, and justification means salvation, eh? If you're justified, then you are saved, yeah? Yeah? So since you have been saved, justified, you are now able to resist conforming to the world. And you would not have been able to resist conforming to the world unless you were saved. Similarly, like I said earlier, we cannot be transformed unless we are saved. So understand, we are speaking from in a sequence. There's a sequence that flows. And let me just speak quickly to save, because save is salvation is a three-dimensional word. We are saved upon confession and true repentance. Remember, I talked about that earlier. Yeah? Justification. But we are also being saved through the process of obeying Christ. So you have been saved, justification. You are being saved. It's an ongoing process through our Christ-likeness, our conforming or transforming the image of Christ, which is sanctification. And of course, it ends with a great glorification, which means we will either be saved through the process, or we will be saved either at the point of death, if God calls us home, or at Christ's return, when he breaks through the skies. All right, so we can look at salvation from those three perspectives. Salvation, you're saved. Justification, immediately. Salvation, you are being saved. Sanctification and salvation, you will be saved. Glorification. So now we are working, we understand now that that has been settled. We are working from a place called new creation or new creatures. So what we are doing, we are not doing what is right in order to make us new creatures. It's important we understand that. You are not doing what is right in order to become a new creature. You are already a new creature. Yeah? Rather, because you are a new creature, you are able to do what is right. You understand the old concept of the chicken and the egg, which comes first now? Because you are a new creature, you will be able to do what is right. Again, we can say it this way. We don't do good works in order to be saved. That's not how God runs his kingdom. That's not how the church is set up. We don't do good works in order to be saved. You can't work yourself into God's kingdom. I can't work myself into God's kingdom. My good works ain't enough to do that. However, once we are saved, we can do good works. And there are good works prepared for us to do, for those of us that are saved. Okay, so we've settled on that, and we will use that as our introduction. So understand in the back of your mind as I go through this morning, remember that we are working from a position of you being a new creation. A new creation. So whatever happens now, where we go from here, we are going from here because you are a new creation. As long as you are saved, as long as you've accepted Christ. So let's look at verse 2 again now. Romans 12. It says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. The first command in verse 2 is in the negative, yeah? Do not be conformed to this world. The Apostle Paul isn't leaving it up to us to determine whether or not we want to conform. It's not a suggestion. We don't have a choice. It's a command. Do not conform to this world. Do not. So as Christians, we know right up front that we have to be careful not to conform to this world. Now, what conform really means? Conform really speaks to an act in accord with the prevailing standards, attitudes, and practices of a society or a group, or in the context of Romans 12, to the world. To act in accord with prevailing standards, attitudes, practices, etc., of a society or a group, or in essence, the world. That's what conforms mean. Or there's another one that says, to be or to become similar in form, nature, or character. To be or become similar in form, nature, or character. Now, right off seeing that definition, we can understand why we are told not to conform to the world. Because it says to me that if I am to go by this definition, that my nature and character is becoming something similar to the world. And we know what our nature and character should conform to. And it's certainly in the world, right? It's Christ. It's Christ. So quickly we understand why Paul is so clear in determining and saying to us, do not conform to the world. It's a serious thing. Now, understand there are things within the world that naturally we need to conform to. So Paul is not making a blanket statement here, but Paul is helping us to understand there is a reality that we need to work with. Now, for example, the traffic laws are there, and if you don't conform to the traffic laws and the police catches you, you know what could happen. And you have to go and pay a fine or whatever, and you can't go in court and say to the judge, well, my God said do not conform to this world, so I'm not obeying any laws. You will probably not even end up at Dodds. You will probably end up in the Black Rock psychiatric. So don't do that. There are certain things we need to conform to, yeah? Paying our bills, paying our taxes, those things. So there's a measure of conforming that needs to take place in our lives. However, Paul here is warning us about conforming to the world system in Romans 12, 2. He's dealing with our mindset. Now, I want you to listen carefully to this. He's dealing with our mindset, our belief system, our attitudes towards the world system. Can I say to you that the world system is inherently evil? It is. Whether you think so or not, the world system is inherently evil. Even sometimes the things that seem good when we watch them and hear them on television, behind that oftentimes is a sinister motive. And we see some of these people doing what we consider to be good, and then when we hear something happen, you know, there's this real negative underlying thing going on. Recently, I heard someone, I think it was on CNN, which talked about a company, I'm not going to call any names, but a company was being fined because they were selling their vehicles more expensive to a certain ethnic group. I don't know if anyone heard that message, that news item, but they were selling a car. And if a white person came to buy the car, they would sell the white person at, let's say, $20,000. But if a black person came to buy the same car, same model, they would sell it at maybe $22,000 or $25,000. And they were actually fined for that. It was discovered and they were fined for that prejudice. So in everything, there's always this little undergirding evil that exists. Because that's how men are. Naturally, we are not prone to do what is good. That's a natural thing for man. I will show that to you as we move on. But the world says things like, if it feels good, do it. A lot of us grew up hearing that. If it feels good, do it. Now, that opens the door for anything, doesn't it? But that's what the world teaches. If it feels good, do it. Another thing that we have to be very careful with in terms of the world system and the world's way of thinking is this is a dog-eat-dog world. We hear things like that. And the connotation there is that you succeed at any cost. Whatever it takes for you to succeed, do it. So even if it means crushing someone else on my way up the ladder, that I do because
It's a dog-eat-dog world. Those are the kind of things that the world says to us is okay. Because the world will celebrate the man at the top. It doesn't matter how you got there. But once you're up there, you're the friend of the world. The world loves you because you got a lot of money, you got a lot of success, and hooray for you. But that process of getting there might have destroyed many lives, many families. But the world's not concerned about that. The world sees success only in dollars and cents. And so, it tells you it's a dog-eat-dog world. Do what you have to do to succeed. And recently we've been hearing, well, not as recent as we think it is, but recently we've been hearing a lot about same-sex marriage. Especially in the first world countries. I'm not sure what that term first world countries mean, but let me use it for point of communication. But we hear a lot about same-sex marriage. Again, the world has decided, the world system, that it's okay for a man and a man to get married, or a woman and a woman to get married. And that's fine. It's love. Let's all love each other and go ahead. But that cuts across God's word. That cuts across God's standards. So here we have a situation again that if we are allowed, or if we allow ourselves to conform to the world system, we will find ourselves embracing things that are antichrist, that are not of God. Interestingly, in this situation in the States, recently they had a young lady by the name of Kim Davis who decided that she will not conform to that. And she spent a couple days in prison or in jail, but she stood to her belief. And our conviction is what should lead us. I mean, she spent some time in jail because of her conviction. But we all know, and I'm not going to ask any hand, raise the hands, but we all know we have situations, even in our workplaces sometimes, where the boss may ask us to tell a little lie. You know, all right, don't mind that. Just say a little lie, you know, because it could get some more dollars for us. Or it could help us keep a client. And we are sometimes pushed against the wall because our conviction tells us, but you can't lie. But the boss wants you to lie to make a profit. And you are stuck. Worse yet, if any of your bosses in here, and you tell your employee to tell a lie, oh gosh, Lord help you. But that also happens. So sometimes we recognize that the world system isn't good for us. And therefore, Paul says, do not conform to the world system. Plain and simple. But this morning, I really don't want to focus too much on the negative. I don't want to focus too much on the do not conform. I think we all understand that reality, yeah? That we cannot conform to the world system. That means we have to press against it. We have to go against it. Oftentimes, that means being uncomfortable. But like Peter and the other disciples says, we'd rather obey God than man. Huh? If you're seeking man's praise, then you're in trouble. But if you're seeking God's praise, if God wants you to please God, then you stay true to God. It doesn't matter what the world throws at you. Yeah? But I want us to focus on the other side of this verse a little more, which talks about transformed. It says, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind. Be transformed by the renewal of your mind. It is not enough just to try through your own human effort not to conform to the world. Really isn't enough. You will fail, actually. This process of being able to resist conforming to the world only happens because there's someone in you bringing about that change. In other words, trying to do it on your own will produce only outward changes, which inevitably do not last. It won't last if you're by your own human effort is trying to make this change. It wouldn't last. The change, the true change, comes from within through the process that we're going to discuss called being transformed. We must be transformed
we must be transformed. And we are told how that process of being transformed takes place. Takes place by the renewal of our minds. Our minds. I think too often, we Christians, and maybe a little more the charismatic Pentecostal background Christians, tend not to use our minds or think our minds are not an integral part of our salvation. But I beg to differ. As a matter of fact, Romans 12, 1 and 2 tells you that that isn't true. The word transformed, I have for you the Greek word. I will not even try to pronounce it, but I think they can put it up for you. The Greek word for transformed is that beautiful word there. You see it? Metamorphosis something. Yeah? And you could call it phufo, I know you won't call it at the end. But that word means to change form. Now, of course, we get our English word, and most of us know it, metamorphosis, from that Greek word, bringing about change. And as a matter of fact, on the graphic for our series, you see a beautiful example of a chrysalis or pupa changing into a beautiful butterfly. And you know that stage of the beautiful, look, it's right there. See that? Where the caterpillar turns to a pupa or chrysalis and then to a butterfly. As a matter of fact, let me tell a quick story on that scenario. Years and years ago, I read a little article on this whole changing over from a caterpillar to a butterfly. And do you know that if you were to see the pupa or the chrysalis and you passed and saw the wriggling and the fighting of the little butterfly inside there trying to get away, and you decide, oh, that butterfly is struggling, let me help it, and you come and poops, put a little hole for it to ease out, you know, and get away, because it kind of trapped. You see it as trapped. You know, if you do that, you will make that butterfly deformed, and it will come out not being able to probably even fly and feed, and therefore will end up dying. So you will do it more harm than good in trying to help it. And that's how our lives are sometimes with Christ. Christ puts us through things, but he's doing it for our own good. And so even though it's a little struggle here and a little battle there, a little tussle there, it's okay. Too often we pray God to take us out of things when God really wants to change us in the midst of the things. Yeah? And we need to bear that in mind as we go through our trials and tribulations. I had an apostle shared a beautiful message a couple of weeks ago on the whole concept of suffering for Christ. Because unfortunately, especially on the western side of the hemisphere of the world, we consider suffering to be a real bad thing. And we don't like to suffer at all. And we just like the goods, the sweets. Bless me, bless me, bless me, bless me. Give me, give me, give me, give me. And we go down that road all the time. When Christ is helping us to understand, hey, there is a real thing called suffering that the church must go through. Apostle mentioned it more than once in his message. Persecution is a natural part of the church. Suffering is a natural part of the church, and we should not try to avoid it. We must embrace it when it comes. God has a good purpose for it. Just like the butterfly trying to get out of that cocoon almost. So the question now, and incidentally, the word that we saw, metamorpho or pho, that word is only used one other time in the New Testament. And that's in Matthew chapter 17, verse 2. And that time was when Jesus was on a mount with Moses and Elijah, transfigured. And it talks about shining, Christ shining like the sun. That's the only other time that word metamorpho is used. This change must take place from inside out. Remember that. A person cannot avoid conforming to the world by just trying not to be like the world. It can't work. It is a process where you need to be transformed. Now, that brings us to a logical question, because we're talking about being transformed by the renewal of our mind. And the question that we can ask ourselves is, what's wrong with our minds? What's wrong with my mind?
Some of us would think that this mind we've been operating with all our lives. Well, that ain't true for the Christians, by the way. Or else it shouldn't be. But there are a couple of verses that I want us to look at in Ephesians chapter 4. It will help us understand the inherent danger of the natural mind. And I'm saying natural mind as opposed to the mind of a Christian, which should be a transformed or a Christ-like mind. Ephesians, I'm going to pick it up from verse 22. Pick it up from verse 22. It says, to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life, and is corrupt through deceitful desires. Verse 23. And to be renewed in the spirit of your minds. And to put on the new self, created after the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness. So verse 23 tells us that the mind has a spirit. There's a spirit of your mind. And what does that mean? What is that saying? It's saying really, I believe, that the mind has a spirit. A mind has a demeanor. The mind has a disposition or an attitude. And can I say to you that the natural attitude of the mind is hostile towards God? The natural demeanor of the mind is hostile towards God. See, the mind isn't just a receptacle for information to process and to reason, etc. But we see that the mind has a viewpoint, or what we like to call a mindset, a disposition. And it is very hostile to God. Romans chapter 8, verse 7 and 8 tells us that clearly. Romans chapter 8, 7 and 8 says, for the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God, for it does not submit to God's laws. Indeed, it cannot. Those who are in the flesh cannot please God. So we see right there, the flesh here, of course, is speaking of the natural mind, the mind before Christ, the mind before you were born again. That mind is by nature hostile against God. The Word of God says it cannot even submit to God's laws. So even if you try in us naturally, outside of Christ, to submit to God's laws. And that shows the danger of the natural mind. And so we should understand from that why it's so important to renew our minds. Your Christian walk cannot be done with an old nature mind. It can't happen. So the question is, how did the mind get this way? How did our natural minds get so own way, so disobedient, so hostile to God? We can find that quickly in Romans chapter 1, verse 28. We'll read right down to verse 31, as a matter of fact. It says, since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. Let's stop there for a second. I don't know how many times you have read that verse, but I've read that verse so many times in my Christian walk. And you know what jumps out at me now there? God is making a judgment on the human race. God has judged the human race. It says, God gave them up to it. Who gave them up? God. This is Satan. Said God. God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. In other words, God placed a judgment on them. Why did that happen? Because they refused to acknowledge God. God says, all right. When they ain't acknowledging me as God, well, take that, boom. Continue in that debased place, and God gave them over to a debased mind. And it goes on to say, they were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They are full
of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, wow, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. That's a description of a natural mind. Now, most of us would say that all those things don't want to apply to any of us, and praise God for that, because you'd probably be the devil yourself. But certainly, before we were Christians, some of those apply to us as natural, as our natural minds. And so that tells us why it is so important that we need to renew our minds. A Christian cannot operate with that mindset. You can't. So we need a renewed mind in order to be transformed. And like I said earlier, this transformation is a process of sanctification. And it happens as a result of us being new creatures. Again, we start out by saying it happens from a position of you being already a new creation, a new creature, a new creation. So because you're a new creation, you can have a transformed life. Because you're a new creature, you can have a renewed mind. Now let me say this very carefully. Very carefully and very slowly. We Christians sometimes like to take what seems to be shortcuts. And somehow, we have this notion that prayer is a shortcut. So what we like to do is to pray to God for something. And then just sit back and wait for God to bring it to pass. Granted, that happens sometimes. But can I say to you, there are some times that praying will not do it for us. Elder Clifford, what are you saying? I am saying that you can pray sometimes till the cows come home. God's response is clear. I have already told you what to do. You do it. You do it. It's an action that is required from us. And in this process here of renewal of mind, it is us that do any renewal of the mind. God will do the transforming through His Holy Spirit, but we got to do the renewing of our minds. God will not renew your mind or my mind for us. So you can pray for a renewed mind from North Coast come home. If you don't do what it calls to get a renewed mind, which is, in fact, we all know, study the Word of God, meditate upon the Word of God, and spend time in fellowship with Christ. Praying, worshiping God. How many times, think about it, how much time a day do we spend in that form with Christ? How much time? So you can't have a renewed mind. You can come to this altar every Sunday and Wednesday and pray for a renewed mind. If you don't go home, and if you don't etch out some time to spend in God's Word, to allow God's Word to bring that change, that renewed mind, and to spend time in God's presence, to allow His Holy Spirit to bring that change, then you will never have any renewed mind. It's hard work. It's hard work. A renewed mind is hard work, church. Our minds, naturally again, has been programmed to be self-centered. Think about it. Naturally, we are programmed to be self-centered from birth. It's all about me. Think about babies. When they're hungry or they want changing, they couldn't care less what a mother or a father doing. Couldn't care less how busy you are. Pay me some attention. I want some food or milk or whatever. Yeah, babies. And that continues throughout our lives, our young children. Whether we want something, mommy, I want this, daddy, I want this. They don't care if you got any money or not. Big deal. That's your problem. I want it. And all through our lives, we grew up being self-centered, naturally. It's all about me. About me. About I. Yeah? It's a natural mindset. You don't believe me? All right. Here's a little test. Think about how many times a day we think about ourselves. What we need to do. What we need to eat. What we need to wear. What we can watch on TV. When we can go on the internet. How we gotta reply to this. How we can, when we gotta do our hair. When we gotta wash our car. When we gotta do our nails. All those things. And we have a good to-do list, yeah? All about us. To do. I got to do this. And we go on the line. And we do that day after day, week after week, month after month, year after year. And so some of us are now 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90 years old, and we tend to still be doing the to-do list for us. Now make a mental check on that to-do list and be honest with yourself, you know, raise your hands, but tell yourself how much of so much time on that to-do list do you have set out for anything to do with God? Think about it. When last did we spend a half an hour just in the presence of God? An hour, hour and a half, 2 hours.
3 hours?
A whole month? 5 hours? And I'm not understand what I'm saying. I'm not saying that to make you feel badly. I'm helping you to understand and to open our eyes that in reality, we are new creatures, so therefore we can do better. We have a different mindset. That mindset belongs to the world. It does not belong the children of God. And so we need to align ourselves with the right mindset, which now says that our lives are God-centered and not self-centered. Now that's real hard work, like I said earlier, you know, because it's so natural to be self-centered. You know that it's even dangerous for us, that it's so dangerous for us that we can be self-centered even in our worship. You know, oftentimes we could worship, and we are worshiping, and we are blessing God, and we are blessing God all because of what he can do for us. And we are worshiping God, God, we love you, because this could happen for me. And all the worship has a point that lands right back at me. Self-centered. It is so easy to fall back into that place of self-centeredness, even as a Christian. We need to be careful. We need to move away from being self-centered. You see, self-centeredness points to pride. Pride. Oh, what a demon pride is. And it's so subtle. Sometimes you don't even recognize that you're walking in pride. All of us, bar none, have to check ourselves often to see if we have fall into that element of pride in whatever we are doing. However, as new creations, we are expected by God to be transformed. The power of transformation and that transformed life is seen through our Christ-likeness. Now, a transformed life is not only external actions. Bear that in mind. It's not simply having a different to-do list, like I mentioned earlier. Moving from the self-centered list to a more God-centered to-do list. That's not what we're talking about here at all. What Paul is talking about isn't that at all. Paul is talking about being transformed from inside out to bring us away from this, from any thought of self-achievement. which is legalism. You know, we could be acting externally with a new mindset or acting as if we have a new mindset, and all the time it's really about us patting ourselves on the back and saying what we achieved. You know, I am more moral than you, you know. I do this, I pray 3 times a day, I do this, I do that, I do, I turn, I la da 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 da. And we again embrace pride even in that process. Paul is saying no. God is always reminding us and warning us in everything we do as Christians to desperately avoid pride. Avoid pride. The work of transformation is really a work of the Holy Spirit. The work of the Holy Spirit. Your responsibility and my responsibility is the renewing of our minds. But the work of transformation is the work of the Holy Spirit. For Christians, our alternative to immoral and worldly living isn't a new to-do list for moral living. But it's really the cultivating of the fruit of the Spirit. In Galatians 5, 22 and 23, and most of us know it, the fruit of the Spirit, that is what brings the transformation. That is how we are transformed. That is how we're able then to resist conforming to the world. You see, you can't do both at the same time. You can't be becoming more like Christ, being transformed in your mind, and still be like the world. It is impossible. Once you are becoming more like Christ, you are resisting conforming to the world. And that is how you do it. It is not a void of do this and then do that. In doing this, you resist that. That is how it goes. Transformation in our lives happens inside out. It's not about us. 2 Corinthians, let's look at this verse of scripture quickly. 2 Corinthians 4. Chapter verse 4. It says, such is this confidence that we have through Christ towards God. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything as coming from us, but our sufficiency is from God. You know what that verse is saying there? And this is something I would say to the worship team a lot over the years. God didn't impress how good you could sing. Big deal. You remember who gave you the talent? God. And so we need to understand that. That applies across the board. God ain't interested in how good you could preach, how good you could pray, how good you could do whatever. All those giftings comes from the Lord. As a matter of fact, we do nothing on ourselves. I don't even use the term, I work for God. I don't work for God. God, I want to work for him. God works through me. Because in reality, if I work for God, then God owes me something. Whenever you work for somebody, there's a wage that is due. God owes me nothing. I don't work for God. I can't work for God. Whatever I do because God enables me to do. God does it through me. And that is the same true for you. Yeah? So we need to have that mindset clearly that it is God who does this stuff through us. And like that verse says, everything, but our sufficiency is from God. It's from God. So that eliminates all the pride issue. So we can see that the power of a transformed life is really the Holy Spirit working through our lives to glorify Christ. And of course, then we have all the opportunity to impact the society, and the nation, the region, and the world for the supreme treasure of our hearts, which is Christ Jesus. Amen? Now let's bring this all to a logical conclusion. The latter part of Romans chapter 12, verse 2 says, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. So the question is, what is the will of God in this passage? What is the will of God? What is it that we need to discern the will of God? What will of God are we talking about? Let me suggest first what I believe it is not. The will of God in this passage of Scripture is not referring to God's sovereign will. And oh, beautifully today we sang so much about God's sovereignty. Yeah? Our worship was focused on God's sovereignty. God is sovereign, full stop. And so, when we look at God's sovereign will, we understand, or we should understand, what we're referring to. Because the sovereign will of God doesn't give room for any opposition or change from mankind. Understand that. When God speaks his sovereign will, or it's called sometimes a decreed will, it does not ask your opinion. It does not leave room for you to speak to it. It is just that. Boom. And that's it. Full stop. So don't ask God, okay, God, suppose I can do this. Can you? No. It's not up for debate. It is his sovereign will. He is God.
All right, let me use two passages of scripture to help bring that home to you. Acts chapter 4. We can soon finish. Give me a couple more minutes. Acts chapter 4, verse 27 and 28. And this is an interesting passage of scripture. It says, "For truly in this city there were gathered together against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed, both Herod and Pontius Pilate, along with the Gentiles and the peoples of Israel." Wait, stop there a minute. Luke here is writing, and he's making sure he leaves out no one. Now this, the whole concept of Christ's crucifixion on Calvary. And he makes sure that everybody's included. He talks about Herod, talks from the kings right back down. Herod, Pontius Pilate, the Gentiles, which most of the time would have been the Roman soldiers and so on, and the peoples of Israel, the Jews themselves. Everybody's included there. Verse 28, "To do whatever your hand meaning God's hand, and your plan meaning God's plan, had predestined to take place." You understand what I'm saying there? That the whole crucifixion of Christ was set up before the foundations of the earth by God. Talking about sovereign will. So here's Herod, Pilate, all of them acting up and doing as if they got some great power to do. Not understanding that they're barely pawns and puppets in God's hands. Working towards God's purpose, God's will. And the Roman soldiers doing as Dixie as they like, think that they can cut off Jesus this and cut off his beard and put on, and we got it good now. And the Jews up there, the Pharisees and the priests saying, "We got it good now." Even Satan joining in that joke band. All the time there are puppets in God's hand. They are doing God's will. They are doing what God has placed them there to do. Do you understand God's sovereignty? Now, what is amazing about that? Let me say this and move on. Is that almost all those people were involved to some extent in sin to bring about Christ's crucifixion on the cross. He was falsely accused. Yeah? So almost everything pointed to sin. But here is all these things that point to sin. It was ordained by God. Oops. Everything that they did in that scripture tells us it was what? It was God's hand. It was God's plan that was predestined to take place. Sovereignty of God. God's sovereign will. Not a man can come up against God's sovereign will. Here, Paul, well, in this case, it was Acts, so it's Luke, helping us to see that reality. That God's sovereign will is just that. And we don't always understand it with our little human, naked, finite, myopic view. And we sometimes can sit, can fly one flap in God's face and why this? God is sovereign. God answers to no man. Let's look at another verse, another passage of scripture. Sovereign will of God. Daniel 4, Daniel 4, verse 28 and 35. Now, I just love this. This speaks actually to God's sovereignty, but it also speaks to the pride that exists, that how God hates pride. So we're doing two in this passage of scripture. It says, all this came upon King Nebuchadnezzar. At the end of 12 months, he was walking on the roof of the royal palace of Babylon. And the king answered and said, is not this great Babylon, which I have built by my mighty power as a royal residence for the glory of my majesty? What pride! What pride! Here he is talking about all that he has done as King Nebuchadnezzar, building this great palace, this royal palace, and it's all about what? His glory of his majesty? Read on. Verse 29. While the words were still in the king's mouth, while he was still speaking those prideful words, there fell a voice from heaven. O King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken, the kingdom has departed from you. The voice didn't even say the kingdom will depart from you, man. God's judgment was so immediate. He says the kingdom has departed from you. Read on. And you shall be driven from among men, and your dwelling shall be with the beasts of the field, and you shall be made to eat grass like an ox, and 7 periods of time shall pass over you until you know that the Most High rules the kingdom of men and gives it to whom he will. Stop there for a second. What is that saying? That every president, king, and prime minister of every nation is placed there by God's will. Now, that does not make your voting unimportant, but it is through your voting, your pen, your ex, and so on, that God places who he wants to place there. Ultimately, it is God. It says there, don't get tied up. It is God who put kings and princes and politicians and prime ministers and presidents in their place. And you know what? It is God who moves them too. Don't fly up in God's face. Let's read on. Immediately the word was fulfilled against Nebuchadnezzar. He was driven from among men and ate grass like an ox. And his body was wet with the dew of heaven till his hair grew as long as eagle's feathers. And his nails were like bird's claws. If you exalt yourself, God will bring you down. Next verse. At the end of the days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my reason returned to me. He began to think again like a wise man. The folly had been moved away, and he now sees clearly the reality of God. He says, and I bless the Most High, and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom endures from generation to generation. Next verse. The other type, next verse. Verse 35, you have it there? All right, let me read it. You don't have it there? Yeah? Because we want everybody to see it. My main technology always gives a little trouble here and there. So don't worry. All right, let me just read it. And if you get it, you can bring it back up for us. But verse 35 says, all the inhabitants of the earth are accounted as nothing,
And he does, this God, he does according to his will among the hosts of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. And none can stay his hand or say to him, what have you done? There it is. Okay. New King James Version is fine. All the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He does according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth. No one can restrain his hand or say to him, what have you done? That is speaking about God's sovereign will. Nebuchadnezzar came up against that and he recognized it finally. After being like an animal, like a beast. Hopefully you and I would not have to go through that in order to acknowledge God's sovereign will and obey it. So back to chapter Romans 12, verse 2. So because of that type of will, I would beg to differ from the belief that this is God's sovereign will being referred to in verse 2. But the other type of will that we can look at is coming what we call God's passive will. God's passive will, or sometimes called God's will of command. This will of God, we can know, but we don't have to do it. It doesn't bear down on us like his sovereign will. In this case, we have an option, a choice to act upon it. Hence, we call it his passive will. Now, understand where we're going. We are at Romans 12, verse 2. It's talking about us having a renewed mind, becoming transformed in order to understand and to do and to live out God's will for our lives. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. 1 Thessalonians 5:18. It says, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Give thanks in all circumstances. Now, if we are honest with ourselves, and I know we are, even though that is God's will, we can all say that we don't do that. We don't give thanks in all circumstances. When things hit us hard and life throws the curveballs at us, we kind of grumble and complain and ask God, why me? Yeah, we do that at times. We do that. But that's also God's will, according to that verse right there. So here we see there is a will of God that man has opportunity to say yea or nay to, unlike his sovereign will. As much as this is God's will for his saints, I think we all can say there are times when we allow our free will, you know, we like to talk man's free will. But you know man's free will is limited, right? Yeah? Our free will is not absolute free will. Our free will is limited, has its boundaries, and sometimes we forget that. Just like in relation to the world and to the society, our free will is limited by the laws. In other words, if you decide to take off your clothes and go out there naked because you got your free will will end up in prison, or again, maybe Black Rock. So you don't have your free will to do as you like, but that free will is guarded, is boundaried. So here we have it, we have a free will, and sometimes our free will impact on God's will. God is willing that we all give thanks in all circumstances. Unfortunately, that is not necessarily the case for all of us. We don't always do it. Even though man's free will does not influence God's sovereign will, but it can interact with God's passive will, even though there will be consequences when we choose by our own free will to disobey God. So you can disobey God, but there are consequences when it comes to his passive will. the consequences. So let's pass the scripture of Romans 12, and we close here now. Romans 12, verse 2. It's speaking to us being, having a transformed life based on a renewed mind. Now, interestingly enough, oftentimes when we look at the word power, we tend to think a lot about miracles and power to move this and a power to do that. But in this context, I want you to understand that the primary purpose of that word power there is power to become more like Christ. It is more about you and I changing. You want to see a miracle? You're talking about a miracle? You think raising of the dead is a miracle? You and I becoming like Christ, that is a miracle, man. You can imagine you becoming like Christ. Born a sinner and become like Christ who created the heavens and the earth. Talking about miracle, that is miracle. So that is the greatest miracle of all. And that is what Paul is focusing on here in Romans 12, verse 2. So the power of a transformed life is primarily seen in our Christ-like character. Christ-like character. Now, I know again that we're praying and we're hoping to see all kinds of miracles and signs and wonders, and that is fine. That is fine. But can I suggest that we pray fervently also to have a character of Christ? As a matter of fact, I believe that once you have the character of Christ, you will see signs and wonders and miracles, because that is what Christ did. So if your character lines up with Christ, then expect your actions to line up with Christ. I think that's a natural progression. So let me close by saying this. I can tie it all together in these three sentences, and then we finish. The only way we will be able to discern the will of God, which is the end, which is the goal of this passage of Scripture. The only way we will be able to discern the will of God is if we are transformed. Let that sink in. The only way you and I will be able to discern the will of God concerning our lives and our families' lives and our nation and so on is if we're transformed. Now, the only way we can be transformed is if we are renewing our minds. The only way we can be transformed is if this mind is being renewed. Is if this mind is resisting conforming to the world, the world's ways, the world's way of thinking, and it's aligning itself with the way of Christ, the way of Christ thinks, the mind of Christ, as it says. But finally, the only way we can have a renewed mind is indeed if we are new creations. So it really comes back to being a new creation. So we end where we started. All of us can discern the will of God. All of us can be transformed. All of us can have a renewed mind, because all of us are new creations, if indeed you're saved. And for me, that is the joy of that passage of Scripture, because it leaves out no one who is called by Christ's name. As long as you are a Christian, you can know the will of God. You can discern that, and you can have a transformed mind. You can resist conforming to the world. You can have a renewed mind as long as you are a new creation. And with that, I want to say amen. New creation. A transformed life. A new creation. A new creation. I want to pray two prayers. First, I want to give the opportunity for anyone in here who is not a new creation. And you're not a new creation simply because you haven't repented and confessed your sins to Christ
and embrace Christ as his Spirit draws you to himself. If you are here and you're feeling the tug upon your spirit by Christ to say yes to him, I invite you to come at the altar and let's pray with you. You want to be a new creation. You understand that in order to know God's will, to have a transformed life, to be able to renew your minds, to resist conforming to the world, you need to be a new creation. It is done no other way. So if you are here and you want that opportunity, I give you this opportunity right here. Come. Submit yourself to Christ, to his cross. If you sit there and you wonder if you should, I believe that you'll be hearing two voices in your head. One is from Lucifer, Satan, and his cohorts, and they're going to say to you, no, you don't need that. The other voice is going to be the Holy Spirit saying to you, you need Christ. You need to be a new creation. I'm giving you the opportunity today. Now is the day of your salvation. You determine which voice you will listen to, which voice you will obey. We're at 30 seconds more. Then we'll close this altar call. I take it then that all of us are here or new creations. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you, ladies. All of us in here are new creations. And so I want to say a prayer for us. I want us to all stand. I want to say a prayer for us. God is so gracious, hear me? Oh, man. Sometimes we don't see the depth of God's grace in our lives. But just know, saints, that God never tells us to do anything unless he enables us to do it. That is a rule, a commandment of God. God will never tell you to do anything in this universe unless he first gives you the power to do it. And so this morning, we are standing here knowing, not guessing, not wondering if, we are standing here knowing that we can know God's will for our lives. His good and acceptable, perfect will for our lives. And we know that because we are new creations. And as a new creation, he, through his Holy Spirit, has enabled us through a transformed life, by a renewed mind, to know his will. So today, I'm going to pray with you. I'm going to pray for us. That we would, and I heard this, someone say this once, and I love it. We will become what we are. We will become what we are. As I pray, you pray too. Father, we thank you that you are indeed our Father, Abba. And you love us before the foundations of the earth. And you called us before the foundations of the earth.
And so for us, you have called us into knowing you, to knowing your will for our lives, for the lives of our families, for the lives of our nation. Father, we count that a blessing that we could know your will. And Father, we stand before you recognizing according to your word that you have said, God, that we need to renew our minds. And we know to renew our minds really means for us to spend more time gazing and meditating upon your word and fellowshipping with you and spending time intimately in your presence. That is how we will renew our minds. That is how we will change our mindset. And we understand that that will bring us to the point of being transformed, which allows us to know your good and acceptable, perfect will. So, Father, we ask you now, God, that we would submit to that truth. And that every life here today, God, and who's watching on live stream, knowing the fact, the truth, that we are new creatures will give us the confidence to act in renewing our minds. Because we're acting not in our own strength, but we're acting because you have made us anew and because your spirit enables us to do it. And so, Father, we declare today we will do it. We will submit to your word. We will spend time in your presence. We will renew our minds according to your purposes and according to your will. Because our desire is to bring glory to you through our lives. And we stand here, God, being told by you, being reminded by you, being nurtured by you to the point of submitting to your word. I pray, God, for every single person here, God, that even as we would leave here today, we would leave here with a determination to renew our minds. We would leave here with a determination to resist conforming to the world. We would leave here with a determination to be transformed by the Holy Spirit so that we can know your will. And so, God, we say thank you. We say thank you because everything that we do, you enable us to do, God. And we say thank you for your grace, for your grace, for your grace, for your grace poured out in our lives time after time after time again. And Father, I declare that these, your people, will never be the same again, God. But we will go from glory to glory to glory as we learn to renew our minds and as we submit to Christ and as we become more like Christ in this earth, shining your light in the earth, this dark world, to see your glory, to see our good works and glorify you. We say thank you, God. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Please have your seats. We invite Elder Harriet to come.
Hallelujah. We give God thanks for his word. Amen. Amen. Well, we just want to spend a few more minutes and we want to welcome all of you who are worshiping with us for the very first time on a Sunday morning. If this is your first time with us, we'd like you to stand, remain standing. This is a time that we just want to greet you and bless God for you being here with us. Thank you so much for being here. And we know that God would have ministered to you in some way this morning in the service. Our hostesses are going to leave a gift package with you. We ask that you complete the visitor's card. You can drop it in the offering basket or you can give it to any of these lovely ladies that are the ushers. And our partners and friends around are going to make you feel very welcomed as we just give God thanks for your life this morning. Amen. Partners and friends, just go and stay with them. Father, we thank you for these who have come this morning to worship in the service with us. We thank you, Father, that you are the one who would have ordered them their steps to this house of worship. We thank you, Lord, that you have a plan and a purpose for every life and that nothing that we do is by accident. And so, Father, we thank you that for whatever reason you would have sent them here this morning, that they would have heard a word from the Lord in this service today. Father, you know exactly where they're at, and you have spoken this morning, encouraging us in your sovereignty and your lordship and your plan and your will for our lives. And so, Father, we declare that your plan, your will, and your purposes for each and every life that is here this morning, that it will be accomplished, that we will be obedient to your word, Lord. We declare blessings upon their homes that today, whatever is the circumstance in their homes, we thank you that you have already spoken healing in that circumstance. And so, Father, we give you praise for them in Jesus' name. Amen, and the Lord bless you. And we trust that if you don't have a home church, that you would choose to worship with us again. We meet on Wednesday evening at 6 o'clock for a time of prayer, and then again on Sunday morning in this particular time of worship. And for Runners for Christ, we'll be meeting this coming Friday evening at 6 o'clock in the evening, and they will be meeting right here in the sanctuary. Just want you to remember also our senior pastor, Apostle Stephen Holford, and Pastor Sandra Holford, as they are away on holiday. Continue to pray for them and for their families as well. We are now accepting partnership forms for our new partnership, and persons who would like to be received into partnership in the ministry, you are invited to collect a form from one of the hostesses, or you can get a form from our office during the week, and you can read it prayerfully, and you can complete the form and leave it with us. Remember, to be a partner in the ministry, you need to be worshiping with us for a minimum of 3 months, having accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, and baptized in water. If you have not been baptized, the new believers classes commenced in August, and they will continue Tuesday evening at 5:30 in the evening, and those classes are held upstairs in our office building, and you are invited to be a part of those classes if you would like to be a partner in the ministry. Equipping Center, our classes for the new semester will begin next week, Monday and Tuesday. On Monday from 6 to 8, Chosen to Lead, which is tutored by Minister Allen, and Born to Write, which is tutored by Paula Richards. And on Tuesdays, 6 to 8, Stepping into Divine Purpose, tutored by Minister Sonia, and Polishing the Prophetic, tutored by Prophet Dwayne. The cost is $75 per course and $25 registration fee. And persons who have done a course before, you're not required to pay the registration fee of $25. And Liz Nichols will be on the outside immediately after the service to register those persons who are interested in these exciting classes. And Minister Sonia and Prophet Dwayne, you weren't here last week when the others shared about their classes. I'm not sure if you'd like to come and just spend a moment sharing about your class. Minister Sonia, y'all are fine. Y'all are good. So how do we know what these classes entail? I don't have the write-up on the classes. And you don't have yours, but it's inside of you, so come and tell me quickly. And you have, your class is a continuation. So Minister Sonia is going to tell us about her class, which is a new class.
Really, the class is going to be a practical class. We believe that many times we have the knowledge, but we don't put it into practice. So this class will be a mentorship course. And what we're going to be dealing with is raising altars. We're going to be dealing with how you speak, how you become a man and a woman of substance, how you function in the kingdom, everything. It is going to be one that will be taught with a lot of practical teaching methods. We're going to be having debates. We're going to be having discussions. We're going to be having people who will do drama pieces and scenarios, and we will be calling you out, and you will have to speak, whether it's for 5 minutes. We're going to critique you. You will have to do whatever God has called you to do. We will critique you till you are the best in the kingdom. We believe that the time has come. Don't just get revelation, but it is time to really leave the mark. And so in this course, I invite all of you come, because at the end of it, you shall be all that God God says you are, we will not stop till you become so.
Amen. So on the outside for these classes, you can register, and I'm sure you would want to be a part of one of these four classes being offered starting next week, Monday and Tuesday evening. And the classes start at 6 o'clock in the evening and go until 8 o'clock in the evening. Relentless 2015. October the 3rd, which is almost here at 6 o'clock in the evening, the theme for this year is Relentless, is Relentless Love, Relentless Grace, and Relentless Power. Tickets are on sale at $25 in advance and $30 at the door, and they are available this morning for sale, and we're inviting you to be a part of Relentless. And if you have friends and family that you'd like to be a part of this, then we ask that you purchase tickets for them. But come and be a part of this exciting evening of the arts as we come together and worship God right here in the sanctuary. Relentless love, relentless grace, and relentless power. And this is all God's relentless love, grace, and power. So we look forward to you being a part of this evening of the arts. Woman of Virtue, on Saturday, September the 26th, Woman of Virtue will be having a special session under the theme, Everyone Needs Love. And we will meet at 4 o'clock in the evening. Our session is for about 2 hours, and everyone is required to bring a love gift to exchange with a sister. This gift must cost you no more than $3, and the aim is for you to use your creativity in preparing your gift. Registration is $2, and we really do want you to register if you want to be a part of this. Because of all the special things we want to do, we want to know how many people will be here with us on Saturday the 26th. We're believing God for a dry evening, because we're going to pitch our tents on the outside, and we're going to have a ladies' evening outside under the tent, and we look forward to seeing all of you. We're going to dress up like real sisters. Don't think that because we're under the tent that I want you to come in your tight jeans and slippers now. So I want you to be tea ladies and afternoon ladies as we... Are you getting me, sisters? We're going to be ladies under the tent, okay? And so that's on Saturday, the 26th. You know, mindset, we have to be transformed. You know, we think of a tent and we think outside in the yard, and what do we think of? Okay, registration is $2. So we ask that you sign up this morning. If you have not already done so, we have some bookmarks which serve as reminders. And if you didn't get a bookmark last week, we have some more this morning. Please meet with the ladies on the outside. June is going to be out there, and also Minister Sonia is going to be out there. They're going to take some information. They're going to give you some information, and we look forward to you being a part of this exciting evening, Woman of Virtue. Reverend Paul Watson's book, Wedded for Disaster, is available immediately after the service. The cost is $15. We want to encourage all married and engaged couples to purchase a copy of this book. Reverend Watson will be our special guest for our marriage ministry on October the 17th at 4:30 in the evening. And we are encouraging all those who will be attending this session to purchase the book, as the discussion will be based on what is in the book. So Marriage for Disaster. So get a copy. It sounds very interesting. I picked up a copy this morning. We want to remember those who have lost loved ones, and we want to remember Janelle Rees. Where are you, Janelle? Just stand so that everybody can see who you are. Janelle lost her father during the course of this week, and so Janelle, we just want to pray God's comfort upon you, and his strength is perfect. Amen. Prayer request, Minister Allen's grandfather, Brother Nichols, he had surgery on Friday, and he's doing well, so we ask that you continue to lift him up in prayer as he recovers. Devotional writers, this is for you. There will be a meeting for all persons involved in the devotional writers ministry this Tuesday at 6 o'clock in the evening. And that session will be held upstairs. Devotional, all of you who are part of the devotional writers, the meeting on Tuesday at 6 o'clock. Community evangelism will take place this coming Saturday the 19th at 3:30 in the evening. We're invited, all the church, to come out, be a part of community evangelism. We're going to meet here in the sanctuary at 3:30 in the evening for a time of preparation and prayer, and then we're going into the community in the New Orleans. So we want you to come and be on time this coming Saturday, the 19th at 3:30. We're going to stop for a minute, and we're going to have our dollar drive, and then we will continue as we celebrate with those who are celebrating birthdays and anniversaries and so on. So let's have our dollar drive at this time. You're doing well. I'm going to ask Granville after this to come and join me as he's going to tell you some further information about Relentless and how you can get it out there to your friends and your loved ones. So come. Somebody's going to play something for us, and we're going to come and give our dollar. Remember, only silver dollars in the blue jar, and anything else can go in the basket or the small jar. Back over my life, and I think things over, I can truly say that I have been blessed, and I have a testimony. And my testimony is that God is good, and that He is faithful, and He is able to keep when we commit ourselves unto Him. That's my testimony. He has kept us. He has kept us through all kinds of stuff. He has kept us. The times that we thought that that was the end, and God came and said, no, this is not the end. I still have plan and purpose for your life. So we celebrate God. I tell you, I'm excited about God all down on the inside of me. Because I'm telling you, if it had not been for the Lord on my side, I don't have a clue where I would be today. But I have a testimony. Granville is going to, Multimedia is going to help us with a little video as it relates to Relentless. And then Granville is going to share a few things. And we're going to get out of the way as quickly as possible so that we can all get home.
New Dimensions Ministries presents Relentless. 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 Come and experience God's love, grace, and power through dance, drama, and song. From top gospel artists such as Pass Quinn, John Yard, Allison Norville, and Sierra. Tickets available at New Dimensions or All Things Gospel stores. 25 early, 30 at the door. Refreshments will be on sale. Come, share in this wonderful experience Saturday, October 3rd, 6 p.m. at New Dimensions, Barbary's Hill.
Good morning. Okay, so Relentless 2015. We had a fantastic Relentless in 2013, and here we are again. So I just want to talk to us about how we can promote this wonderful event. It's an evening of drama, dance, and music, as you know. We have some very fascinating people that will be performing, worshiping. It's going to be an awesome event. Well, it's only 3 Saturdays from now. So I'm an accountant by profession, so I don't know much about marketing. But what Coca-Cola has taught me is that the magic of promoting something is in its repetition. And they also tell me that the best form of marketing and advertisement is by word of mouth. People trust the people. If people trust you and know you, they will buy whatever it is that you're saying to them. So, and thirdly, is that you should promote and market to your appropriate target and demography. Now, here's a fantastic event that, in my opinion, we don't need to do much public marketing to get this place filled out. Because we already know the people who will be attending this other event. They are our friends. We know them from work. We worship with them at other churches and so on. And we have them on our Facebook page. So what I want to talk about is, how is it that we can promote this event cheaply and effectively through social media? New Dimension Ministry has a webpage that you all frequent, New Dimension Ministries. If you should go on that page, you will see a link to Relentless 2015, an event page on Facebook. So the first thing I would like for each person to do is to visit Relentless 2015 events page on Facebook. You could just search for it, or you could get to it by virtue of going through New Dimension Ministries. It's right there. It's an event page, and therefore, what I would implore you to do, each person, to do this week, not next week, this week, is to go to that page and indicate whether you're going to be attending or not. But more important than saying whether you're going to attend or not, what I'd like for you us to do is to invite all those persons who are on our Facebook as friends. It's cheap, and it's effective. So you go to the Relentless 2015 events page, and then go and invite. And you can do all the invitation all at once. Click Dwayne Howard, click Granville Duran, click Elder Harriet, and so on and so forth. It's a one-time event, and it will go straight to each of your friends. They will know about that event. So that's one thing that you can do. The second thing that you can do is the poster. This poster is also on the Relentless 2015 website. What I would suggest that you do is you share it. Share it firstly on your timeline. Sharing on your timeline, as you know, all of your 2050 friends will get a chance to see that this event is happening at Dune Dimension on October 3rd. So that's another way. Thirdly, what I recommend that you do is to share the page with those persons that are close to you that you think would have an interest in this page. It's only $25. The reason I'm asking you to do this is we'd like to at least share and promote at least each person in the church at least 3 times in the next 3 weeks. Can you do that for us? To promote, well, the invite can only happen once. You can only invite once. That's how Facebook has it. But you can share and promote as often as you want. So we're going to ask you over the next 3 weeks to share on your timeline and also share with friends the Relentless poster. Now, here's the thing. When you go and share on your timeline, may I also recommend that in the comment line, you tag people. So I can once again hit up Prophet Dwayne. When I post this poster or repost this poster, I'm going to tag Dwayne Howard, okay? So he's gonna hit him one more time. Okay, so it's cheap advertisement. It's already, we know who are the people who want to come to such an event like this. It's inexpensive and it's quite effective. So we want to fill out this place with 1,200 persons on the 3rd. We don't have much time to do it, but we can do it. So let's see you. I want to see those posts this week and next week and the 3rd week. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Granville. Amen. And we just also want to continue to thank you for those of you who are able and remember to support the food bank. Remember that if you are not want to remember when you get to the supermarket, you can always make a little donation and put it towards the food bank, and you can place it in the offering basket as we continue to meet the needs of those who come to us weekly. We want to celebrate with those who are having a birthday today or this coming week. Would you stand, the birthday people? Wow. Okay. All the birthday people all over the place. Amen. The Lord bless you. All the singers, don't move to hug. I need a singer to sing the birthday song for me.
A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday to you. Every day of the year, may you find Jesus here. A happy birthday to you, a happy birthday.
for the lives of all those who are celebrating birthdays today and this coming week. We declare purpose in your life, that you will identify the purpose for which you are alive and then step out to accomplish that purpose in Jesus' name. Amen. What about those who are having a wedding anniversary today or this coming week? Would you stand? The anniversary people. Am I missing anyone? Any wedding anniversaries, wave at me because I might be missing you in the movement. Okay. Nobody got married early September because it was back to school for other people. Amen. Well, the Lord bless you. Okay, that's fine. Okay, it's time for us to give. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Our hostesses are prepared. It's been good to have been in the house of God today. Lift your offering, lift your hand, lift something up before the Lord. And Father, we just honor and bless you this morning. We thank you, Lord, that you think about us, Lord. Father, we thank you that you care for us. We thank you, Father, that you are our provider. We thank you, Lord, that you are our source. Father, we declare that for every seed that is sown today, Father, even as the rains fall, that you will rain upon the seed sown. Father, for every desire to sow seed, Father, we thank you that you will give seed that we might be able to sow into the kingdom of God. We thank you, O God, for all that you have blessed us with. And as you bless us, God, I pray that we would not be stingy, that we would not be selfish, but Father, that we will share with others who are in need. Father, bless the gifts of your people. Bless the businesses that are represented. Bless the workplaces that are represented. Bless the small businesses, the home businesses, everyone that is represented in this place. Father, we lift them up to you. And we ask you, O Lord, that you will continue to reign in our lives, God. And we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. The Lord bless you as you give.
New Dimensions Ministries presents Relentless. 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 Come and experience God's love, grace, and power through dance, drama, and song. From top gospel artists such as Pass Quinn, John Yard, Allison Norville, and Sierra. Tickets available at New Dimensions or All Things Gospel stores. 25 early, 30 at the door. Refreshments will be on sale. Come, share in this wonderful experience Saturday, October 3rd, 6 p.m. at New Dimensions, Barbary's Hill.